3 months were there, I was like, how to start? Like in the very beginning only, I was like, where to start from? I have some scattered notes, how to, where to start from, where is JSON, where is JS2, everything is mixed up now. So what I did was, don't be in a hurry to make note as soon as you read something. Take a pause, make yourself understand, get a clarity, and then make a one pager note. It will really help. And how I refined, I started giving the mocks from the very first day. I scored very low marks in my first mock. But then I understood that where I'm lagging behind, my structure was not right. I decided one thing, like, I don't know what people are going to start from. I feel comfortable when I start my introduction from a fact which is relevant to the question. Don't write a data which is not relevant to the question. Half of us did this mistake in the mains, that we wrote certain things which were not even being asked. You need to follow the newspaper every day. But by the end of the month, you kind of forget a bit of things. And just to connect your current affairs, just to give you an overview of what happened last month, you can refer to monthly magazines. Don't make notes out of it. It's already a crisp note of certain current affairs.
Swati is into the Indian Foreign Services. And she has her own story of going there. She cleared this exam in her very first attempt. And she did her Indian Foreign Service training first, which happens in Sushma Swaraj Foreign Service Institute. Earlier, it was known as Foreign Service Institute. After that, it was named in the name of our late Foreign External Affairs Minister, Sushma Swaraj ji, right? So it's in the JNU campus only. It's a very beautiful place. Go to Aruna Asaf Ali Marg and you will be able to relocate that place, right? So she has done some segment of her training there, and she has had a lot of attachments. She has been to and I think everywhere now, most of the places she has, you know, explored. She has recently been to Washington also. And now, because she could not attend Labasna, she was doing training in Foreign Service Institute. So she is under special FC. So with very difficulty, she has been able to take out time. And I'm very grateful for her for doing that. And Swati,
Thank you so much.
Welcome to this session. And the topic for this session, as you know, is note making. Especially for 2025, 2026, because we have beginners mostly who are attempting this paper now, right? And they are Gen Zs also, most of them, because you know that the era of millennials exam is really no more there, right? So this is your, you know, the theme of the day. And they have a lot of questions because I was interacting with them before you came. So they have a lot of confusion regarding note making and how to, you know, make them crisp and how to really start and have faith that their notes are very, very genuine and they really don't need to copy any topper note per se.
Yeah, of course.
Right. So this is one confidence you will have to give it to them. So Swati, if I may start the session, how do we actually start? How do they actually start? If they are starting now in October and their next mains is in August, how do they start the process?
I mean, the first thing that you should go now, like if your next mains is in August, the first thing is to cover the syllabus. I hope that every one of you who is preparing for the mains have a copy of syllabus in their study table. Like, it should be stuck on your study table, and you should have by now remembered the syllabus by your heart. Like, you should know what is there in GS1, which topics are there, because that actually helps. While you read the newspaper, now, there are a lot of things that you need not to focus more upon. Like, you can read a newspaper, but there are certain topics which you have to read very carefully because they are the part of the syllabus. So by now, if you know the syllabus, you know what to read and what to avoid. So as to save your time, because it's a very comprehensive, elaborated syllabus, and you really can't read each and every line in very depth. So I would say that for now, the first thing is to get a hold over the syllabus. You should know what the syllabus is, but which topics are in GS1, which topics are in GS2. And specifically for mains, one more thing is that from the very beginning, segregate your notes according to your subjects. Like, you should, preferably I did that, this, so I suggest everyone, because you should have a copy for GS1, you should have a notebook for GS2 and GS3. And then kind of write, you should keep it very organized. Like, I understand that whatever I'm saying, it takes a lot of time and energy, but then, you know, it really helps. While you're preparing for mains in the last 1 week, I say, like, I suppose that a lot of revision needs to be done. So that revision can only be done if you have comprehensive and crisp notes, which you can look and you can get an idea of the whole topic and how you have to give an introduction, what you have to write in. Like usually we prefer using facts in the introduction to kind of make it more, you know, it's more scoring for that matter. So start making notes in a very organized way. You know, if you just make random notes now and then towards the mains, you start organizing them. You're doing, it's duplication of efforts, I would say. So from the very beginning, just segregate your notes and make it in a very organized way. Write a topic. And if you get, if there is one topic in the syllabus, GS1, like art and culture, whatever you have read, you can make a crisp note 3 to 4 pages according to the topics given. But if you come across any current affairs, you can actually leave 7 to 8 pages for some current developments that you can update in that topic. Like, it needs to be very organized. I hope you guys understand like what I am talking about. It needs to be very organized from the very beginning. Because, you know, mains is like you have to write a lot of tests. You have to revise a lot. You have to remember a lot. And you have to make notes of everything. So it gets very confusing towards the end, like the last week wherein you are preparing for your mains. You need to be very organized. You need to save your time. And only if you put in your effort and time from now, then you can understand that that will actually yield in some positive result towards the end of your preparation, like when your exam will be approaching.
Swati, I would want you to highlight on crisp notes, because see, they understand that note making has to be done, and they may organize them also according to the syllabus, as you see. But see, eventual aim is to lead towards a micro formation of notes. So your notes might be bulky in the beginning, but you have to fine tune it to micro notes, which you can also call it. Can be called as crisp notes, correct? So how do they actually go debulk their notes, if this is a right word, for a lack of a better word, how do they debulk their notes and actually make them comprehensive, crisp, or micro, whatever can is the right word?
For that I tried one thing. Like, it's really difficult to debrief and like debulk, like as you said, debulk any note, because you feel that urge that this is also important, that is also important. Like it's really difficult with the preparation. As much as you read, you feel everything is important, so you start adding everything in your notes, right? So for that, what you can do is see the previous year question papers and understand a pattern. Especially in mains, it is easier. Compared to prelims, it's easier to understand the pattern. Like, if there is one topic given in the syllabus, try to just make 2-page notes for that. In GS1, if there is one topic, try to just make 2-page notes. How that will come? That will come with your, like, I would say you evolve during the preparation. Initially, it would be very difficult to segregate which is important and which is not. But as, I would say, for now, you can make a kind of comprehensive note. But as many as tests you will write, you will understand a pattern of the exam. You can try the previous year question paper. You start giving the mains test series. Then you understand a pattern. And then while preparing, that 3 months that you get between prelims and mains, what you can do from the existing note, you actually get a clarity as if what you have to add and what you have to remove for the sake of making it more crisp. So that is a perfect time of making your notes crisp. Like, it's really difficult to kind of target crisp notes from the very beginning, because you get overwhelmed with lot of data around. Lot of things are happening around, lot of current affairs are there. You have to give a historical brief and everything. And I would not suggest you to make notes with the first reading. Like, this is really overwhelming, because, once you read a book for the first time, you think that everything is important. So I would say just give 2 or 3 readings of a book or any notes, and then kind of make a decision that what you have to add in your notes and what you don't have to. That will give you more clarity once you practice the previous year question papers and get a like, you need to have a clarity over where which things are important. There is a pattern which is being followed in the UPSC mains. If you see, there are 2 questions in security and everything in GS3. Environment is there. Climate change is there. Then Arctic region is very important when it comes to mains. They ask innovative solutions there. So what you can do is just evolve with the preparation. Initially, don't get overwhelmed and start writing everything. I have seen people making notes out of newspaper.
Could you give an example? So for instance, let's take polity. Okay, and you say that you polity notes have to be prepared in multiple readings. So if a student has is beginning and he starts with polity, say with Lakshmikant, okay, if not at Indian Constitution and work, Lakshmikant, at what stage would you suggest him to make notes? And what would you call a comprehensive or a crisp note? What would you mean by a crisp note? Any topic you might recall, if you are able to recall, could be fundamental rights, could be president, anything. Just an example, at what stage they should be making notes, and when can those notes called be crisp? That's it. Yeah.
So basically, for example, if you take polity, please, when you just pick up that bulky Lakshmikant book, first of all, Lakshmikant book is not enough for mains.
Yeah.
That is that many people, I don't know, they feel like polity to ho jayega Lakshmikant. It's not that. You please see the syllabus. GS2 is very comprehensive. You need to have a very comprehensive understanding of GS2. It's not, polity is just one part of GS2. So, for example, polity, if you have to make certain notes from Lakshmikant, you can only do it after your sixth or seventh reading of the book. I think reading the book, understanding things, then you know, when you will come there for the eighth time, then you will understand, like, if there is in parliament, you just need to write Lok Sabha tenure, who else are the member of the committee, just a very crisp kind of note. Don't write very elaborate notes of it. Like, don't just make a book out of a book. That's what I mean. That you need to kind of use very keywords you can use from that thing, and from where you will get the understanding of these keywords, from the previous year question paper, from the test that you are giving, you will understand what keywords are often being used by the examiner. I mean, then you will understand, okay, if they are asking you the process of like they in polity, I remember they ask a question over the what is the difference between the election of the French president and an Indian president, what is the difference in the election machinery. That you won't get an understanding in the Lakshmikant book. What you can do there is that you need to refer to many sources, but then not make notes of everything.
Yeah.
You can keep certain things in mind. You keep reading them thrice, four times, fifth times, sixth time you will get to know. Once you know the syllabus, once you have five readings of that stuff, then you know what you have to write.
Okay.
But
So when you say six
even
to
you can
seven times,
start...
when you say six
Yeah,
to seven
yeah.
times,
I actually, I would like Lakshmikant, everyone reads 6 to 7 times, even in the
correct.
first attempt.
So just for
it's
beginners, just for
something, yeah.
Swati, I need you to tell them that time will gradually reduce, so they will not take same amount of time with every reading. So is this
Yeah,
correct?
that is the thing. I
Okay.
don't know if I'm sounding a bit like overwhelming 6 or 7 times, but I'm telling you, the first time you might take 3 months to complete the
Yeah.
book.
Yeah.
The second time you already had underlined the important things, so you're just reading that. The third time you actually get an idea of what content is there in what particular chapter.
Correct.
So it's like it is not that way that you it will take the similar amount of time with every reading, given that you maintain that consistency. Like, it's not like you read the book 2 years back and now again you're thinking of it a second reading. You need to kind of maintain that consistency while reading, and kind of understand things rather than just mugging up.
Also,
Like,
the role
just
of
wait, just
PYQs.
pause, take a pause. Why PYQ is very important. That's the thing what I have been highlighting since beginning.
Yeah, correct.
PYQ give you clarity. You know, you need to know what keywords you have to pick from that chapter or from that topic, and from where you get these keywords. When you see that in PYQs, like UPSC has a pattern in mains. They ask certain questions from certain areas. That is very clear. And that comes with practice. As many PYQs you will practice, you will get to know that there is an understanding of keywords in UPSC, and that keywords can be highlighted from your reading, from your multiple readings.
Okay. So wonderful, Swati. So I think with this, we finished the first segment. The second segment I would want you to highlight to the students is value addition. Because as you yourself said, that Lakshmikant is not sufficient for mains, which we agree, right? And we have just seen the recent GS papers. I don't know if you got the time to see that or not. But value addition, there is some amount of value addition you would be requiring in your existing notes to make it mains ready. So Lakshmikant, for instance, is a very good for book for prelims. The notes you make from Lakshmikant will be helpful to clear prelims. But when it comes to mains preparation, you will need to add certain value to it. Could be data, facts, committee, you know, a lot of best practices And the competition is tremendously increasing thanks to the AI coming into the picture. So, yeah, how do you value add your existing notes? You don't go and, make a new set of notes when it comes to value addition. But in the same existing notes, how do you value add? Or how did you value add? Or what's the ideal way?
Okay, so what I think that I had this crunch of time, like it was the first attempt and I didn't have a background already in the arts thing. So I actually had to start from scratch and I didn't have much of time to kind of go through different sources. What I did that after Lakshmi Gan, whatever topic were left, what I did was that I just Googled it on internet. There were many websites that were showing elaborate kind of discussion, debate, understanding of that topic. I just read them through. And then I made my own understanding. And then I referred 3-4 sites and just noted it down and in the form of one pager note. Like if there is a topic, the different constitution differences, like different constitutions, it's written like, I don't remember exactly because it's been a long time
comparing,
since I was
comparing constitution.
Yeah, comparing constitutions. So what I did, I just had a brief reading of different websites wherein they have compared different kind of different countries' constitutions. I just made 2-3 points from each website and I made a one-pager note of that. So when I have to refer comparing constitution topic from GS2, I'll just refer to that one-pager and will not go to the website again. So it's just that don't be in a hurry to make note of everything. Take a pause, read it, understand it, make an understanding, understand yourself, like make yourself understand how you have to write it. Like it's really time taking, doesn't come that easy. You have to kind of make yourself understand, okay, these are the different kind of things that they have written while comparing things. Like if you need to compare federal structure, tenure, election machinery, like 3-4 topics, and then kind of read different countries' machinery, like constitution, like how it is being compared. So just read it and then make a note, like how you have to make a, I'm really sorry for the call, how you have to make the notes in your pages. So it should be just one pager crisp note. Don't be in a hurry to make note as soon as you read something. Take a pause, make yourself understand, get a clarity, and then make a one pager note. It will really help. And then you can leave one page extra so that in future, as you read, and if you come across any interesting fact, you can just add it in that same thing. So my focus has been like, it should be very organized. I know it sounds really difficult, but your notes, if your notes from the very beginning are very organized, it really helps you in the, especially in that last week, wherein you have your mains prep, mains just the next week. In that 1 week, you have to revise GS1, 2, 3, 4, everything along with your
optional two.
So it gets very overwhelming if you have scattered notes, if you don't know where to refer from, you have written things in 5 copies, it really gets overwhelming.
So coming back to comparing constitution only, Swati, so if I see a theme, comparing constitution is a recurring theme. I go to PYQ and I see Britain and US questions have been repeatedly asked. And this year also it has been asked. So I get to know that Britain and US is a recurring theme in comparing constitution. Now I need to value add to that, right? Apart from the existing knowledge. So virtually, if you can run me through what points could, would or would you consider in any of these topics,
actually one thing that I really came across was that in 2022 it was French and India,
yeah,
the constitution,
correct.
The president,
I remember that,
because,
question,
yeah, because it was in the news,
yeah,
so that gives you a hint, like wherein you have to put your stretch, like you can't read every constitution in detail, but you know which to read and which not to read. That comes from the how closely you are monitoring current affairs. Like it should be from current affairs. I saw like many ongoing political cases were there, and their political kind of polity was being asked. The polity of the politics that was being asked in the question. So like there was some issue in my own state wherein there was some dispute with a state governor and CM. That question was asked in the GS2. But not giving it the political overtone, but the polity of the politics.
Yeah.
So if you closely monitor your current affairs, what is happening around, that gives you a hint, like wherein, because it becomes very, random. You have the it just writes comparing constitution. And if you want to value add, you can just read the constitution in detail of every country. That becomes very difficult. But you can read in details and add value to certain things which are in current affairs.
Okay.
So that really helps. Like if there is some election going on in some country, please understand and read how its election machinery is, how the constitution defines election, what is the electorate defined of, everything. I mean, what is the process in total? What is there in current affairs? So that gives you a hint. In terms of value addition, yeah, your monthly magazines do help. Not to learn, but to revise. You
Oh.
need to follow the newspaper every day. But
Okay.
by the end of the month, you kind of forget a bit of things. And just to connect your current affairs, just to give you an overview of what happened last month, you can refer to monthly magazines. Don't make notes out of it. It's already a crisp note of certain current affairs. So
Okay.
please, that urge, you know, that urge we do get while preparing. Make notes of everything what we come across. That is actually time consuming, and that really doesn't help. That will only, towards the end, you will feel that your notes are scattered. You don't know what to refer from. You have six copies for GS1, right? And you don't know, you actually, it gets very overwhelming in that last 1 or 2 week while you are heading for.
Right. So, can you hear me, Swati?
Yeah, I can hear you.
So I was actually talking to a ranker, rank 61, Khushali. She told me that, sir, I used to even write pointers from Dainik Bhaskar or, you know, Rajasthan Patrika, because I thought that these papers nobody's looking at. People are only looking at Hindu and Express. And these papers have a good, like you also said, some regionalization question. You
Yeah,
thought
yeah.
that was happening in your state was being asked. So these Hindi newspapers or these regional papers also sometimes have a very, you know, good level of journalism in terms of statistics that people tend to ignore. And she told me that that became my X factor, that I used to, you know, incorporate these sources in my preparation that people will not naturally. And of course, her own personal experience visiting Anganwadi with her mother and these things. So she used to bring in those examples so that, you know, her value addition looks different from others' value addition, which others will be obviously following the generic sources. So of course, your time was not a ChatGPT time, thankfully, but her time was, of course. So the competition was increasing, and she had to do some. You know, something that is out of the box. So would you also recommend something like this, since the competition is increasing, or you would want, like, what would you have done if you were attempting again this year after
Okay.
the aftermath of ChatGPT?
Yeah, I would say giving examples from your own life experience, that actually helps a lot.
Huh.
Like, but it's really difficult. Like I'm telling you, very few people can manage in that exam stress, you know, that reminds you of some of your life experience, any question. That is very difficult because you are under that pressure and your thinking process actually slows down during in the exam hall. Like outside the exam hall, you can write very, very beautiful answers. But in the exam hall, it kind of slows down because of the pressure. There is time crunch, everything. So what you can do, like for value addition, is that of course life, your own life experience helps, especially in essay and ethics, to give a good start. You can actually think of the essay topics. We used to start from a story, and we tried to make that story appealing to the invigilator. Like it should be an interesting one. And we somehow, what we used to do is that in the end also, we used to give a glimpse of that story so that we can cover up the whole story in the form of the essay that is being asked. Like our essay revolves around that story.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is what we used to do. I don't know, before ChatGPT, we actually crafted our own stories. And
Wonderful.
yeah, but that comes with practice. As many as essays, as many as topics you have practiced, you have written, you know how to navigate through. Like it really doesn't come, like you have to practice 30 essays before writing your mains. So that you get that kind of habit of thinking, like how to start it, because it needs a good start, an essay, to maintain that flow. You need to structure your essay before you kind of end it. You need to structure it in a rough page. We are being asked that always structure your essay so that that
True.
flow is maintained. And for that structuring, you need a story. How you actually have to have a story that time. It makes your things interesting.
Right.
Other value addition point that I would like to suggest is that facts do help. Like, if you add certain facts and that facts come from how closely you are monitoring current affairs, how good you are at remembering data, I would say, like, really data helps. Like, if you just start the introduction with the data, it gives you a good start. Rather than just writing a generic state the introduction, if you add certain important data which is suitable, like which is relevant, don't write a data which is not relevant to the question. Half of us did this mistake in the mains that we wrote certain things which were not even being asked. First of all, to understand the question properly and then using the data as an introduction which is relevant to the question, that gives you a good start. So that could be one thing that you, if you're good in remembering data and facts, then you already have an advantage over others who are not good at it. But then you can do you can add other things. You can add you can add pictures. Like if you can if you're good at making maps, just make a small map and kind of add it, because you know there is a time crunch. Even I was not able to complete my mains paper. There were 10 marker or 20 marker which I couldn't finish. So, but what I did, like, I made something. I made a map. I made a world map. As soon as possible, I just created a world map. They were asking about fishing zones. I remember I couldn't write the whole answer, but I just made a world map. And the three fishing zones where the ocean currents meet, I just marketed them. At least I get 1 or 2 marks there out of 10.
Correct.
So you need to kind of cultivate that creativity, and that comes with practice. I mean, there is no substitute to practice. You have to write as many as answers, give as many as mocks, just to understand how you have to give a good start. Just to and that you know, once you start writing now, that actually also helps you to remember data. Like if you write many answers, you actually go back, you see. If I could have given a start wherein I could have actually added a data, by that way you actually go after a data and then you remember it. Like it actually helps. Answering, practicing answers, it actually helps. Practicing is one key which is irreplaceable in mains. You have
Great.
to kind of practice a lot.
So before I jump to the last segment with you, Swati, last section, a lot of questions are coming to me, like around 200 questions, which are personalized for note making, and I don't think Swati can answer them. So there is a link by Civil's daily team, a Bitly WhatsApp link. You can send your notes or whatever questions you have, irrespective of note making also, and our mentors will be able to connect to you. Okay, I think team is floating that link. Swati, I'm asking the relevant questions that can be clubbed in my theme so that Swati also saves her time and we also do a save of time. Okay, so Swati, again jumping to the last segment, before that also, how did you make notes, digitally or handwritten? What was your way, and
I have
when
handwritten
yeah,
notes.
second part, when in the exam
Sorry.
hall, when in the exam hall you were not able to recall anything, okay, did you recall your notes, or like your mind went back to your notes? What How did you actually draw thought of making a world map just to fill in something so that you don't lose that those extra marks? So what was the thought process there, and of course, how did you make notes, digitally or handwritten wise?
So I had handwritten notes, and one thing that really helped me that in that I actually initially, because it was my first attempt, I also got that overwhelmed, and I wrote very comprehensive notes. But what actually I did that in that 3 months between prelims and mains, I refined my notes. Like I remember I refined my notes, and I just had 2 pages. For every other topic, I had 2 page notes, and I kept revising that. And I revised that multiple times. Even before the mains, before giving GS1, in my car, I was re revising that notes, that 2 page notes for each topic. So it was like 20, 30 pager for GS1. So 20, 30 for GS1. So what I did, I revised it. And that actually helps. Once you are outside that exam gate now and you want to revise certain things, because you will see people revising things. And if you have made already no, made notes in 6 to 7 PDFs or in copies, then it's very difficult. That's why that's where the importance of crisp note comes. It helps in revision. So what I did that in 3 months, I refined my notes and kind of because I gave 30 mock tests, I got an understanding as if which topics are being repeatedly asked. I kind of had risk of ignoring my other section of the comprehensive notes and only selected those which actually followed a pattern which UPSC asked. So risk is one thing that you have to take. Like you
That's
get that
absolutely
thing,
true.
Yeah,
I mean,
risk is something you have to
Animesh this
take.
year
You have to.
ranked 2, wrote 50 Samachar Manthan tests. And he was very consistent in writing 50 tests. And a lot of our students don't write 50 tests. So
No, very
I
young.
feel, the hard work that is required, 30 mocks, Animesh writing 50 mocks. You know, if you don't write these tests, how would you actually judge yourself? Or how would you know where to improve? So students, of course, you have to write tests. You cannot be, there is no easy route, of course, from
Yeah,
this preparation. You
definitely.
have to slog hard. You have to give tests. Okay. Yeah, please continue. So I remember a point. I remembered a point. That's why I interrupted.
Sure. So it's like you have, I refined my notes, and like GS1 I had 30 to 40 pages. GS2 I had 40, and I made those notes out of my own comprehensive notes. Like I'm telling you, as a first attempter, I had this thing, like that urge of making notes of everything I come across. Like just make a note, what if I forget? Like there is this urge. So I made very comprehensive notes, and the 3 months were there, I was like, how to start? Like in the very beginning only, I was like, where to start from? I have some scattered notes. Where to start from? Where is GS1? Where is GS2? Everything is mixed up now. So what I did was that I started revising my own comprehensive notes and started adding the current affairs as value addition relevant to that topic. So I started refining my own comprehensive note into 30 to 40 pages. Like for GS1, I had 40 pages. For GS2, I had 40 pages. So I didn't write the whole sentence. Like just write the keywords and move on. Like you are able to understand your notes. You don't have to show it to someone or use different color of pens and everything. It again depends on you if you want to. But like I made a very rough note which I can understand and revise. So for that 40 pager really helped me while I was standing outside my main center. I had that time while there was a break. I had that time to revise my GS3 and GS4 before I go for my next paper. So I had that time. You know that revision is very important. And in that, I only write those things which I may forget. Like I know if there are certain facts, certain data which I might forget. I'll write those things in my notes. I'll not write those things which I have an understanding of. And that comes up with practice. You know what you're good at and what you are not while you practice. So again, it all boils down to the fact that practice is very important in mains. Like once you practice, you know your strengths and weakness. And then you work on your weakness. And how do you work? You just write those crisp note contained of things which you might forget. You know you might. If there's certain data, if there's some diagram that you might forget. You have written in the mains mock and you have not performed well there, and you feel like you should have remembered that, but you couldn't recall. So only those things which you feel you couldn't recall in your practice test, you write that in your 40 pages GS1, GS2 thing. So that is the thing how you can make your notes crisp. I think it takes a lot of practice and hard work, like, and
Correct.
you need to be very consistent with your tests that you give.
Swati, last segment. Then, of course, you may go. Of course, I know you have a very busy schedule. I'll take not more than your 10 more minutes. Okay. So, the last part, the ultimate aim of note making is answer writing. Okay. We have to write very good answers. In fact, to the perfection in a lot of questions, so that we get that one or two extra marks that other people may not have gotten, that to get an interview call. This is the aim of our note making only. So note making, revision, and answer writing, all three go hand in hand, and note making is the first step, right? So note making to answer writing, right? So how do you really see this? What is your thought on this? And of course, how do we make good notes? How do we revise on time? And how do we make a write a perfect answer based on these those notes only, even in mock test and in the actual exam hall?
So basically, for making notes, again, a syllabus precedes that. Like you need to have an understanding of the syllabus. Like your syllabus is your main guide for note making. Then, from note making to answer writing, I would say that when you make notes, you don't have much exposure to what questions are being asked. You just read and make notes. But once you're done with a fair revision of things, you refer to previous year question papers, you start giving mocks. Like I have heard people saying that once I'm done with my syllabus, I'll start giving mocks. I can assure you will never get that feeling while you're preparing for mains. You're never done with your syllabus. Like you'll always feel that there is much to learn, and then you don't practice enough. you end up reading a lot, you end up making notes, but you don't practice it. Like you don't give mock tests in a limited time frame. Like you in a 3 hour strict 3 hour time frame, you have to give exam as if you have to check kind of how much you can recall from the notes that you have prepared.
And what about the FOMO part? Because
Okay.
fear of
Yeah,
missing out.
that thing is very real. The
UPSC
FOMO
has
thing,
asked a
like
question also on in the essay paper. If you look at the essay paper that happened day before yesterday, that they clearly wrote this out: fear of missing out, FOMO, because it means that they have understood what Gen Zs are going through, and that is being replicated in the exam. So FOMO happens here also. While I'm doing an answer writing. If I do an answer writing in a practice test or a mock test, and something does not come from my notes, I will go and add more to it. I'll go and add more to it, and I will not never trust my own existing notes. So how do you really how what would you suggest to these aspirants? How do they deal with fear of missing out,
So
especially?
one thing I would say, like this is a psychological thing, more of any academic thing that you can, the fear of missing out. You need to take risk at every step of this exam. That risk of not getting overwhelmed by the information around. Like there is a lot of information around. If you go to some bookstore, there will be thousands of books on one single topic, and that fear of missing out compels you to buy each of them some day or the other. You end up buying 1,000 books for one single topic, and you end up wasting your time. Just by giving a first reading of 3 books for a topic, you waste your time. I mean, it's not effective reading. You are just increasing the volume of the books that you're reading, but you're not reading anything quality. And then you get bogged down by that information that is around. You feel that fear of missing out. Take a risk. I mean, it's more of a psychological game, I would say. Take a risk to not to refer to something which everyone is referring, and to refer something which suits you. Like it comes from a psych. It again, I'm saying it's a psychological game altogether. It's not like if everyone is reading certain notes and that you feel is very bulky and doesn't suit the way you are reading. If you are more comfortable with online notes, with some crisp notes that are available and not the comprehensive ones, you please take the risk of choosing what suits you. That fear of missing out actually is not at all effective and wastes a lot of time of yours,
Right.
and which is very precious during this preparation, especially for mains. Like you will feel that time crunch from the very first day, the 3 months gap that you have been given by the UPSC to prepare mains. I mean, you will feel like every day you have this feeling that we don't have much time to prepare. Even though you are completely prepared, your notes are done, you have given 30 tests, you still get that feeling like we are not prepared enough.
Right.
And how to save time? Just take the risk of ignoring a lot of things for one topic. I mean, just go for an effective reading and effective note making. I know effective is not clear as if how effective. I would say just read a lot. Don't have this urge to note everything what you see around, and then see and then identify your strength and weakness through practice. Make
Right.
notes like what I did. I made comprehensive notes, and then in that 3 month I refined that. And how I refined it, started giving the mocks from the very first day. I scored very low marks in my first mock, but then I understood that where I'm lagging behind, my structure was not right. I was giving very long introductions and then very short. I was not writing what is being asked. I was writing irrelevant content. My introduction used to be 7 to 8 lines. I mean, my structure was not good. But then I kept practicing and then I understood that I am good when I start my introduction with facts. So then I started noting down the facts from the notes that I've already prepared. Like this should come to me. Like I should recall it immediately in the exam hall. I'll revise it that many times. So I included all the facts that I have mentioned in my comprehensive notes into my crisp note. And I started kind of, I identified the topic in the syllabus. And then I kind of thought that when this topic would come, I would most preferably use this fact to start my introduction.
Wonderful.
So that is how I was looking at syllabus on one side, PYQ on the other side, and my strengths and weakness I was calculating side by side.
So what she
Like, okay.
wanted to say is that we all start with paragraphs. Okay.
Yeah, of
We
course.
all starts with we all start with
We
paragraphs.
all start with paragraph. I used to write 8-liner introduction, and I ended up getting very low marks in my first mock. But then I kept improving. I kept reading, making my notes crisp. That I decided one thing, like, I don't know what people are going to start from. I feel comfortable when I start my introduction from a fact which is relevant to the question.
And
That
you
gives me a
identified
confidence.
that strength of yours through mock tests, correct?
Yeah, that comes from mock tests. Like, I used to give a very generic, I used to again replicate the question in my introduction with a because, and then I used to write like that's the story of my first mock, 7 to 8 liner introduction. So, when then I found that with practice, if I write a fact, I was scoring good, and I was good at recalling them because I have already noted them in my crisp note. So
Right.
I kept revising those facts even outside the main gate, I remember. Like, I was standing outside and my paper was about in an hour. So I started reading those facts again, and that came to me in my mind. I was able to recall even in the exam hall under so much of pressure. So my introduction thing, I was sure that I'll not have to put much of my brain into it. It
Right.
will come to me automatically with that practice and with that crisp note that I had, and that I made after giving many mocks, after understanding that I'm good at starting my introduction with facts. It differs. Like, it's not like toppers. Other toppers would say you other things. They are comfortable with writing a generic introduction, but they ended up scoring well. So it all depends on your comfort level, your strength and weakness, and that will you will only be able to identify. No one is going to identify on your part. Like, you will be only be able to identify once you practice a lot, once you have an understanding of the syllabus.
One last question, Swati, before I, of course, let you go.
Sure, sure.
Before I ask the last question also, see, I will be there. Many other mentors will be there. We'll take all of your doubts. If you are in a rush, you can always, WhatsApp us on the number, on that Bitly number that has been floating. Just WhatsApp and you may leave. Okay. If you have to leave urgently. If you have some time, I and other mentors will answer all your questions. So Swati, a lot of aspirants, they're giving multiple years, 25, 26. So if I take 26 as the benchmark, could you give them a virtual timetable, like what should they should be doing till 2026 or 2025 also, if you can, your call, a virtual timetable, start now. That's it.
Okay. So I would like, but it differs. Like, if you're in college, then I would say that take your college studies very
A
seriously and only do
generalized
it. Yeah, a
timetable.
generalized one, I would say like 26 attempt. Start reading newspaper, and start developing interest in the subjects. Like, if you are start with a newspaper. Like, I also started with newspapers back in class 10th. So I was very good at newspapers. I was very good at debates, quizzes, and that actually increased my quest of reading newspaper current affairs. So I started reading newspaper back in class 10th, and I kept that habit. So, once you develop, first of all, develop this habit of reading newspaper every day. So from now till 2026, you have to read newspaper every day. So you can start reading newspaper. That will actually give you a basic overview of things around you. Then I would say suggest you pick up that syllabus of the UPSC and have a look. Understand different topics therein, whatever is being there. Like, there is history. If you don't have any background of how UPSC exam is, and if you don't have any arts background, you have never seen these subjects before, sociology and anthropology, just read the syllabus and make an understanding of how things are. Take it slowly. Don't get overwhelmed in the very beginning. It will just kind of it will reduce your interest in the preparation. It's a marathon. You have to maintain that consistency, that interest throughout. And for that, don't get overwhelmed in the very beginning. Start with newspapers. Start to develop like this habit of reading newspaper every day. Then move on to syllabus, and then gradually start with your NCERTs if you don't have a background, to make a foundation over which you can build on later with the standard books. Don't go and buy Lakshmikanth the very first day. Like, if you already have an idea of what NCERTs are, if you have read it in class 11th and 12th, revise it to kind of bring it in your fresh memory, and then build on it. Like you need to create a foundation. You just can't start with. I have seen many people buying if they have decided to attempt a UPSC, they'll just go and buy Lakshmi Kant on the very first day. That is now you get very overwhelmed with the things. You don't have the idea of what half the book is saying. So take it slowly. Start with a newspaper thing, and then read the syllabus. Even and always keep referring to syllabus. That will give you a very targeted objective, like very targeted approach. If you need to have a very targeted approach and don't want to get overwhelmed with the things around, always refer to syllabus. Always keep, I would ask you all to keep a copy of a syllabus on your study table. Like always refer. Like if you're reading polity, just look at what syllabus is for UPSC, for GS2, for polity in particular. And then while you read your NCERT, just read those topics carefully and build a foundation if you're preparing on your own. Because I prepared on my own, I would kind of give you that. Make your base very strong. And that comes with your basic NCERTs. And then build on it. Then gradually, once you read the NCERTs, I would say NCERTs you can finish in next 4 months. So I would say by April 2025, you could have finished your NCERTs. From May 2025, you can start reading the standard books. The standard books we all know, Spectrum, you have 11th, 12th for more medieval and ancient history, Satish Chandra and R. S. Sharma. You have Spectrum, you have Geography 11th, 12th book, G.C. Leong. These are standard books and gradually move up the ladder. Like, don't get overwhelmed. Just after polity, start Lakshmikant. Lakshmikant will take next 3 months. So by August next year, you'll be able to get for to read, to have a first reading of Lakshmikant. Then move on to the syllabus again, and then start identifying topics in GS2. And then from September 2025, what you can do is make notes of the GS2. You can initially make 6-7 page notes. It's okay. Then in that 3 month, you can refine your note, wherein you will be wholeheartedly preparing for mains. In that initial, you can make comprehensive note, and that only after 1-2 reading of Lakshmikant. Just don't be in that urge of noting everything. If you feel like you might forget things, just write. Towards December of 2025, if your prelims is in May, till February, December to February, dedicatedly prepare notes. Because by that time, you would have read Lakshmikant thrice or four times if you are serious enough. And then you are ready. Like you will have this 3 months to prepare notes. From March to May, you can only practice your prelims answer mock test. Like last 3 months, don't bother more about mains. Write more practice tests for prelims. I would say March to May. Till February, December to February, wholeheartedly prepare notes for the mains. Don't think that prelims ho jayega, then we will look for mains. No, it doesn't happen that way. You are not here to crack prelims. You are here to crack UPSC. You have to have that, you need to think, you need to have that, far-fetched thought process while you're preparing. You just can't think of the present. You have to think what I will plan for next 2 months. Farsightedness is very important. Like, I think the exam evaluates a person during the preparation as well. Who can think? Like, who is farsighted? So you need to have a clarity that from March I'll be engaged in prelims. Then I'll not be able to look back into my mains preparation. So from December to February, whatever I have read and whatever is there in syllabus, I will make up even comprehensive notes. I will make notes for GS1, 2, 3, 4, and optional. Till February. If it is possible, be ready with your mains notes. From March, wholeheartedly prepare for prelims, crack prelims, and in those 3 months between prelims and mains, start refining your notes with practice. You already have a notes which you prepared from December to February
Any
for every
amendments
subject.
for 2025 aspirants quickly? Any amendments for 25 if they're starting now in the same program?
If they're starting now, I would say that I suppose this that they have a basic understanding of the subjects
They should have.
already.
They should have.
They should have. I understand that. Then I would say again from December to February, I would say start revising whatever you have read by now. Keep referring to syllabus, and then till December, just read. Just don't be in urge of making notes as of now. From December to February, again, prepare your notes of whatever you have read so far. even though if those notes are comprehensive, it's okay. My notes were also comprehensive. I refined them only in that 3 month period that I got between prelims and mains. Only by giving mocks, only by identifying my strength, I started converting those one notebook GS1 into 40 pager. That is the 3 months that you've been given. You also revise your note, you keep adding value addition through current affairs that is going in that period, like recent current affairs that you are adding. So in that 40 pages will consist of each of these. From December to February, start making notes. Till February, get done with your notes. From March, don't think of mains. Start practicing prelims mock and practicing PYQs. March, April, May. I think these 3 months should be purely dedicated to prelims. Till February, get done with your notes that you will refer. Don't think of preparing notes in the 3 months. No one is doing that. I mean, it's like people have already prepared notes. It's just that they are refining in that period. And if you start making notes in that 3 months, keeping this thought with you that once prelims is done, then I will think of mains. I mean, you're already at a disadvantage. So prepare your notes by February for your mains. And from March to May, prepare your prelims and then start afresh from June for your refining the notes that you have already prepared for mains, keeping the syllabus in mind.
Wonderful. I'm so grateful for you for like grateful to you, Swati, for coming here, taking out your
Oh,
time,
thank
precious
you.
time. And thank you so much. I'm sure this was wonderful and such an enlightening session. Thank you so much, Swati, for sharing us and the students your experience. I hope you have a wonderful training period ahead. And students, you may leave, Swati. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for calling me here. Thank you so much. It was great honor interacting with every one of you.
Same.
Thank you so much.